Jim Irwin. What's up?
How's it going, guys?
Going great.
It's amazing, man. It's amazing. Okay, so we need to just jump in real quick and just find out just a quick overview of you know, what you've done.
A quick overview of what I've done. So how much time we got?
We've got.
Do you want the reader digest?
Seriously, let's just. We've got however long you need. Biography, loose.
No. Briefly, I grew up in a small town in the mountains of California, Mammoth Lakes, June Lake, up there in the Sierra Nevada mountains, and just grew up, you know, running the mountains and hiking and playing football and all the sports. You know, I lettered in every sport in high school, but not because I'm good, but because there was only like 16 kids in the school, so we all
had no choice.
Right, that's awesome.
Right.
I had a high school of about 75 kids, small school. Knew early on I wanted to join the military, and not very common knowledge is early on I wanted to be a Marine. And then learned my lesson early with a recruiter that stood me up on a recruiting. He was supposed to come talk to me, never showed up. I was like, well, if he's screwing me already, I wonder what it's going to be like if I join.
Yeah, no shit, yeah.
I ended up meeting an Army Ranger, former Ranger from Vietnam, and he's telling me some stories. I'm like, dude, that is it. That's what I want to do.
Right.
And, you know, I read all Carlos Hathcock's sniper books and all, you know, and books of his adventures and things he's done. And it just, like, intrigued me. And I was like, I want to do that. So I joined the military specifically to try to become a Ranger and a sniper, and I succeeded at both. I made the training, and I ended up getting sent out to Fort Lewis, Washington for the 2nd Ranger Battalion up there, and became a sniper right after there was two ways of going about it, and early on I had two jobs. So I was in an assault platoon, in a platoon where we do, you know, recons, raids, ambushes, all that kind of stuff. And I was like the saw gunner, but my secondary job was I was also a sniper for that platoon, me and another guy.
Okay.
And then right after I got out of Ranger school, and I did about a year, you know, it was private and everything, go to Ranger school, get my tab, come back, and they actually made a set, like a sniper squad. It was like 6 of us. So that was my designated role. That's all I did was sniper stuff for the company, and then it went to the battalion, not the battalion level, but yeah, it's company level and battalion level, and it kind of went back and forth. Anyway, I spent most of my time there as a sniper. Wasn't even sure what the hell a pistol was at that point.
right.
Did about 4 years there, and then ended up going up to Alaska. Did a couple years in the regular army up there, and
nice.
And lo and behold, I ended up as a scout sniper up there.
Perfect.
Go figure. Heard about this place called Delta Force, and the Delta Force recruiter came through. Fort Wayne right there up in Alaska, and I was like, of course, hell yeah, I want to try. That's a hell of a, sounds like a badass job. So, you know, raise my hand. Yeah, I want to try out. About a year later, I made it, and it's about a year-long process of, you know, doing everything you got to do and the paperwork and the psyche valves and physicals and the actual selection process itself too, you know, before you can be selected. Absolutely amazing job. Out of almost 100 people, I was one of 5 guys to make it in that selection. So the attrition rate is extremely high. I think the best saying I've heard so far, you know, is from a former unit guy was, they don't always take the best guy, they take the right guy.
Mm-hmm. You know, so yeah. Awesome.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I've read a incredible process that you guys go through for selection, like you said, the psyche valves, yeah. And I mean, and just like that quote says, I mean, it's not really the best person that makes it; it's the right one. It's totally true.
Right.
Totally true. I think.
So, quick question: what goes into the psyche valves? What is that?
No, that's a mystery.
Look like?
for anybody but those guys that are putting it on, I actually don't. I couldn't tell you what they were looking for, but there's a lot of questions. Basically, making sure you're not looking to just get trained to go start whacking dudes like on your
right,
own.
Right.
I'm going off the grid.
Going
here
rogue.
Going rogue.
Yeah.
You know, make sure you're stable, man. They look for intelligence. You have to be an intelligent man to be there. Any of the volunteer units in the military is a higher than average intelligence levels. I mean, they screen for that stuff and make sure you're level headed and you can think outside of the box. And, you know, like I said, that goes through all the fields, whether it's Army, Navy, Marine Corps, Air Force, any of those that have these guys that are out there doing, you know, the not everyday job, and you know, and appreciate all of them doing it.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Speaking of which, let's jump into the Veteran Sportsman Alliance.
Yes,
That you guys, that you do work with. Do you want to share what that is all about?
So the Veteran Sportsman Alliance was started by a man by the name of Brett Johnson and his daughter, Cheyenne Johnson. It was actually Cheyenne's idea, and at the time she was 13. So 13-year-old girl.
That's too cool. Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
And the idea was that we should help more veterans. Brett was injured. wasn't a veteran. He's a civilian guy, you know, working in the construction industry, plumbing and stuff like that, and was injured. Man, his back got really tore up, and he got pretty down, depressed, and fought his way back, and you know, got his life back and everything. And so his daughter's like, if you can do it, we can help veterans do it. You know, that are just disabled, this and that, and hating life, or you know, just ready to check out. What can we do? Let's take them on a hunt or something like that. So that's how it started. They took one guy, and next thing you know, it started, you know, snowballing, and more people are finding out about it. And now we're helping several. And one of the beauties of Veteran Sportsman Alliance is that we don't just help one vet one time and then okay, check the block, next guy. You know, and try to build this. Hey, look at us over here.
Right,
you
know, right.
It's more of a, you become family. It's a family after that. We have several vets that we've taken out more than once, and we'll continue to. They, like I said, they become family. We've taken out double amputees, triple amputees, female wounded vet. I just took a female wounded vet on a hog hunt 2 weeks ago.
Really?
Wow.
Nice. Yeah, how was that?
It was a great time, man. She was excited, man. She got herself one, and was a little freaked out at first, man. Yeah. And she was just like, you know what, this is pretty awesome.
That's cool.
I took a wounded vet down to Texas on a buck hunt, a mule deer hunt down there. It was nice. A good time. He got his buck, and that meat was going to help feed his family for a while. And when we do this, we set him up for success throughout, not just this one time, like I said. So when we get these guys in or gals, you know, these wounded veterans that become part of our family, we take them out. Say on a hunt, for example, we've done fishing trips, and we took a guy to Sturgis, and you know, just a race car, you know, a racetrack, take him to a car race and stuff.
Gotcha.
So it's not just specifically that,
right?
Getting him out and experiencing life again. And what was I just saying? What was that?
Taking people down to somebody to a buck hunt down in Texas, and
other than hunting.
Yeah, we do other things besides on the side. We've taken them to, like I said, Sturgis, took a guy to Sturgis. And,
that's sweet.
And it's a variety of injuries. It doesn't have, okay, this guy must have, you know, one leg missing or this, you know, they took me in and I just have a terrible memory. TBIs I probably haven't even documented yet.
That's awesome.
So, that's a great organization. Everything. Oh, so, yeah, where I was at, just to prove my point. Yeah, I remember what I was talking about now.
You know, we do that all the time.
We do, more than we like to admit. Take this guy out, and we'll set him up with a rifle, optics, you know, binoculars, rangefinder,
nice.
Camouflage from Kryptek Outdoor, and that is all theirs to keep. They walk away with that.
Really?
You know, yeah. That's theirs forever.
You know, that's amazing. Cool.
So that can do it again. You know, even if we're not around at that time, they still gives them the tools to go out and keep doing it.
Oh, absolutely.
And everything we do is based off charity and fundraising. So by the help of other people and getting out there, understanding what we're doing, why we're doing it, there's tons out there, and it's sometimes it's a battle to have to prove yourself as a charity organization because there's been, how do you put it? It's been a smudge on the 501s out there and these wounded veterans things, and dudes just trying to get over, you know, make some money and get cheaper hunts or something. You know,
I
can't point a finger at anyone. I won't. We don't do that. And so we basically beg, borrow, barter, you know, whatever we can do to get discounts on firearms and stuff like that or optics. We work with, like I said, Kryptek Outdoor, Savage helps us out. You know, I don't know if we get them free or not, but they give us big discounts on stuff. Beretta,
nice.
Leupold, several others. I can't even think of all of them that help us out. And then we do auctions. You know, one of my other jobs.
I think Hornady was one that I saw.
Yeah, Hornady probably is
Hornady.
One of those. Yeah. So these guys come out and either donate or give us big discounts off stuff, so we can in turn take these guys on hunts, and like I said, they don't pay for anything when they come out, and they walk away with things to help them further on. So, I'm not paid. I'm the chapter president for Nevada. I have another buddy of mine, who's a former unit member, who is the chapter president for Oregon, who got me involved. And then the headquarters is out of California. We're starting up a Texas chapter. So I don't take a paycheck. I donate my time, energy, money to get out there and help and give back.
That's amazing.
That's so cool. And that's really what it takes. I think a lot of people don't realize that, you know, and and you can be anybody. You know, you don't have to be somebody with some background or some a lot of money or this or that. I mean, it's just making that effort to get out there and, mm-hmm. and help people.
Right.
And
we, we started implementing spotlights into the episode where we do spotlights for organizations or people that are doing amazing things. And that's really our point around it, is just encouraging people to get involved. And
you don't have to be a soldier or a veteran to be a part of it. You know, you want to help out. We have a bunch of guys that are civilians and know. Mm-hmm. We got a master chef that helps out, you know, donates time, energy, and does cookouts. And I've taken donors that actually paid. They auctioned me off one day at an auction to come hunt. I hunt with a hero is what they call it. I don't believe I'm a hero, but whatever it takes, right. man. Whatever right, you want right. to tell. But they got to go spend 3 days with me out hog hunting.
That's so
at,
cool.
At our place, Rawhide West Outfitters out of Redding, California, that does a lot for us, and they donate hunts. And so these guys paid, you know, a certain amount of money, drove on down, and then spent the weekend hunting with me and a couple of the guys and the founders, and had a great time, drank some beers, told some stories, and you know, they had a blast. They got to harvest a pig, and that money went to helping another wounded veteran go on another hunt or fishing. Right. So I think it's a great cause. I've seen a lot of them out there that I thought were good ideas, and then you start digging, you know, peeling back the onion a bit, and you're just like, all right, like, not all that money's going to these veterans. You know?
Right. That's a huge issue for sure. What would you say is one of your most memorable experiences from taking some of these vets out? I'm sure you have a ton.
Yeah. The most memorable is really the look of satisfaction and their accomplishment. You know, when they go, we had a triple amputee. You know, this dude's got one arm, both his legs gone, you know, one from about mid-thigh. The other one's gone completely, like from his junk over gone.
Okay.
Like, so he's got this hip thing and half of, you know, part of his right arm. And to see that guy harvest an elk, you know, a bull elk, and the look of satisfaction and just accomplishment and victory, you know, just that does it.
Right.
That's so cool.
That's amazing.
That really is amazing. It's so cool that people like Brett, you know, and his daughter actually, you know, stand up and take action to, you know, form these things. And, you know, again, it's something that anybody can do, and get involved with.
You put your mind to it, and you do and you're doing it for the right reasons.
Right, right. And we'll put all the links in the show notes, too.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah.
I don't remember all of them off the top of my head. VSA USA, you know, on Facebook, and I think it's VeteranSportsmanAlliance.org online. You know, I spend so much time out there trying to do the stuff, I sometimes forget, like,
absolutely.
What was the website again? You know, we'll make sure you got all that information.
Absolutely.
If you guys listening are willing to help, every dollar helps, man.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Absolutely. So go check out those show notes, everybody, and get involved. It's it's an incredible organization. Mm-hmm. Everything that I saw looks amazing. Some amazing sponsors, and like Jim's saying, I mean, just that satisfaction, you know, seeing this satisfaction on these people that, like you said, I mean, would just be on the verge of checking out and calling it quits. And, I mean, you're saving lives. Like, you're literally saving lives.
Yes.
So, and with that said, if you want, we can go ahead and jump into the Q&A session.
Yeah, man.
We kicked out some questions
to
some of our listeners, and they sent us back some questions to ask you. And if you're good to go with that, we'll jump into that.
Okay. I'm not single. I'm sorry, guys.
I wanted to
turn the podcast off now.
Right.
Wait, come back.
I wanted to jump back in real quick. Go back to when you said that you joined the military because you were intrigued. It was intriguing to you. What was the pull for you? What
pull for me is growing up in a town of about 600 people. It was a gorgeous area, you know, top of the mountains, man, and just you can go out your back door with a gun and go squirrel hunting or, you know, this and that. But I wanted to see the world. I wanted to challenge myself. You know, physically and mentally, to get where I wanted to be in the military, because I knew it was a volunteer unit and you had to be at the top of your game to do that. And I wanted to always prove to myself that I could do these things. And I continue to do that. I don't know how many times I've failed at business since I've been out trying to start a company, a logistics company or a tactical gear company or this or that. And you're like, all right, well, that didn't work. Let's try something else. You know?
Right.
And I've stumbled upon this brand ambassadorship stuff that I do now. My fallback and what I continue to do still, and I'll come back to what you're saying on that, is I do protection, you know, high threat protection, low threat protection, executive protection. And I did the high threat stuff for about seven, eight years after I got out of the military, hitting all the lovely spots of the world, you know, Iraq, Afghanistan, Bosnia, Israel, just keeping Americans safe while they're out trying to do the right thing. So what drove me was, like I said, again, the challenge and wanting to see the world. And I know I didn't have the money to just go fly around the world by myself. So, you know, maybe the military got me to some cool spots and I got to see some of that stuff, but it also set me up for success with what I did to be able to put myself on the market and to do the protection stuff and go see these places, you know. And I, now I'm working for a rock band, you know, and I travel the world. I mean, I'm headed to – I just got back from South America. I was in Sao Paulo, Brazil, in Buenos Aires, and then Thursday I take off. We'll do the U.S. – I do U.S. run again, hit parts of Canada, and then – in November, I'm going to Japan, Australia, New Zealand, and I'm staying in New Zealand and going hunting for a week after the show.
So, nice. You know, it's cool to have the freedom to be able to do stuff like that, right?
And to be able to have the type of job and work for the type of people I do that are cool with that, you know, like
right.
You know, they respect that and they're okay with me going to be able to do extracurricular things afterwards. And you know? I'm not traveling all over Europe. And, I haven't made it to Africa yet. I will one day get over there and do some hunting.
There you go.
But hunting is a big passion of mine, so that's one of the things. Is I try to do all this stuff so that I can find the money and time to, on my off time, go hunt. So I've been home 10 days, and I've already spent six of those days hunting.
Right. You know, 2 days up here, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, 3 days up here with Silverline Films doing photo shoots and videography. So what drives me and what drove me then is, like I said, the challenge, that sense of adventure, and being able to see the world and set myself up to be able to do that. And it's allowed me to work for myself and continue to do what I want to do instead of doing what everybody else wants you to do.
Right. That's the goal. That's what we're all about here.
Yeah, for sure. So for people that don't know what responsibilities, like being in the Delta Force, entails, could you just briefly highlight those?
Yeah, I mean, it'll be vague just because that's the nature of the beast when you talk about a place like that.
Okay.
But my job is, once I got through selection and was put on a team in a squadron, is I was an assaulter. So my job was counterterrorism, hostage rescue. Being a surgical shooter is basically the best way to put it. You know, you're paid to be a precise shot, being able to take that headshot with a hostage know, right there and do it quickly, confidently and accurately. Having that job and being able to do that type of stuff, you know, requires a unique, I think, mindset and ability to turn it on and turn it off when you can. Mm-hmm. But that was my job. There's several other jobs. You know, I was also the assistant breacher on the team. That entailed me helping build all the charges for any assaults that we were going to be doing, carrying almost everything I could, you know, the breaching tools, extra charges, quickie saw, you know, for being able to cut into stuff. We had some specific type of other breaching devices too that I don't even know if those are common knowledge, so I won't even touch on that. But so I was kind of like the pack mule for the team. I was one of the bigger guys on the team too.
Right.
So,
of course.
Know, I wasn't the fastest runner, but damn, I could carry a hell of a lot. You know?
Right.
Give it to Jip.
Yeah. It's basically it turned into back. A pack mule.
Right.
And I loved every minute of it. I got my first deployment, you know, overseas there. You know, went to Bosnia during the Balkan War. You know, that was pretty damn cool. Met my ex-wife there. You know, it was a long time ago. But, you know, the thing happens for a reason, so I ended up leaving there and going to a long-range surveillance unit and running their free-fall program. So I was the free-fall platoon sergeant. And so the last 2 years of my career, I basically skydived.
Nice.
You know, you know, hit the woods and skydived. You know,
That's sweet.
And teaching guys how to do it and do it right. So that was a very enjoyable job as well.
Oh, I have no doubt. It sounds like a blast, honestly. Yeah. What would you say is one thing you wish you knew beforehand going into Delta? What's something that
how hard it was? I probably wouldn't have gone.
Really?
No, I'm kidding. I still have to try.
It's like you just talked about liking challenge, man.
Right.
I think that something that might have helped me was just more of an understanding that just what once you get there, it's like big boy rules. I mean, you show up. PT was on your own, so PT, physical training. There was no formations, and you didn't go out and run as a platoon or a squad. That was on you, and you were just expected to perform. That would have been interesting to know prior to, because stuff like that drives me, and one of the reasons I enjoyed being a sniper too, because it's me and my buddy, you know, me and my partner, you know, very much on your own and out there, and we report back to command, what have you. So getting there, you know, in these big boy rules, and it's up to you. I didn't have to depend or rely on somebody else to get me through something. It's on
you.
You know? And that was a pretty unique thing that would have been interesting to know early on. Like, and maybe I just totally missed it. I don't know. Maybe that was information was there and I just totally missed it. But, you know, you get there and it's you know, you better show up with your A game every day because the day you're not an asset, you're gone. Mm-hmm. And I found that out too. So I stepped on it one time and that was enough to get me, you know, excused from the unit, unfortunately. But
yeah,
it wasn't because I was a bad shooter or anything like that. I just made a decision that wasn't agreed with on with the other guys. So.
Oh, gotcha. Right. Anyway. Gotcha. Yeah.
Absolutely. So quick question. What makes a great leader in your mind? Going through all this stuff, you know.
That's a difficult question. That's a difficult question, man. What makes a great leader? I think with the leaders that and the people that I looked up to as leaders, I think their ability to listen was huge. And then they would make a decision, and you'd go with it. You know that, mm-hmm. and they did it with confidence, and they led from the front. You know, they didn't tell you how to do it; they'd show you. You know,
right?
And I respected that and appreciated it, and tried every day that I was in a leadership position to emulate that.
Right.
So, and having that ability to listen, you don't always, as a leader, you don't always have the answers. And if you listen, and I learned this even after when I was doing some, and I was in a leadership role in a protection team over there with several guys in Iraq, the guys around you can have some great ideas if you just listen, you know. Just because you're in charge doesn't mean you always have the best idea. So
that's great advice, because I think a lot of people get carried away with that. Like, oh, I'm the leader. I'm in charge.
Just we're going to do it my way, and that's the only way.
Right.
And, you know, I made that mistake. And fortunately, I didn't get anybody killed or hurt before I, you know, switched on. I was like, you know what? This one guy pulled me aside and told me something. And I was just like, you know what? You're absolutely right. And it changed the way I did things. And then I started, you know, doing that mental checklist of the leaders that I emulated, or followed and held in high regard. And that was one of those things. Yeah, they did listen, you know. And then they would make a command decision. You go with it. Whether it was his idea or my idea or his, you know, he listened and then created his own plan, and we went with that, you know, and led from the front doing it.
That's awesome. That's awesome. What advice would you give to somebody that's an up-and-coming leader, somebody that's looking to, you know, go into ROTC or looking to go into politics or any kind of leadership form? What would you say to them?
What would I say to them? I know what I want to say, but I shouldn't.
Let loose, man. Let loose.
How do I say this? It's more own your decisions and what you've done. And see, too often now, if you look and watch TV, it's appalling. And mm-hmm. it's, well, they did this, and she did that, and he did this, and we all didn't do that. And, you know, and it's a finger-pointing thing. And if you did something wrong and it was illegal, own it. You know, don't hide it. And then all of a sudden somebody comes up missing that's worked for you for 20 years. You know, you might be getting tracking what I'm saying.
Right.
But,
right.
You know, own that, man. As a leader, you need to take responsibility for your actions and the actions of those people under you. And at the end of the day, you're responsible, you know. That can be a tough pill to swallow, you know. When one of your subordinates does something wrong, and you just say, we'll just fire them. It was their fault. No, it was your fault, you know. You allowed that to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and even if you didn't, it was still under your watch, you know.
Exactly.
So be responsible. Take responsibility for your actions and those around you that you're in charge of, you know. Like I said, lead from the front, man, and be honest. And sometimes honesty gets you in trouble. But at the end of the day, you'll know, for me, you'll know where I stand.
Exactly.
Even to a fault. Right. Ask my girlfriend.
She knows.
I'm brutally honest about everything. And it is just, at the end of the day, I can still walk away. Even if it was a bad decision I made, I can walk away saying, at least, you know, I was up front and I owned it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Right, wrong, or indifferent.
Right, yeah. Right. And that's honestly like just having that peace of mind, knowing that you're fully content with yourself and your decisions, I think is huge.
And your friends around you will know. They'll understand.
They
will either like you or love you for who you are, but they'll always know that you're not bullshitting them, you're not telling them one thing and somebody else another. That's important to me.
That's huge. So it seems like you're very experience-driven. driven by the experiences of life.
Yeah, because I ain't got no school. Right. No. My life's been an experience, man, but I've never been to college. I learned all my stuff. I learned all my stuff on the street.
On the street?
Maybe the street on the Army bases.
So, yeah, yeah. So what's the next thing for you? I mean, you've pretty much experienced most of everything a human can.
Well, I wouldn't say that. I mean, I've never been to the top of Everest. Never will. That just looks insane to me. I'll never ride a bull, and I'll never swim with great white sharks. Right. That's just stuff I don't want to do.
There you go.
Oh, man. Literally, like, you just listed off the shit that I just wouldn't do. Yeah, like,
period.
That
period.
Just yeah. like just hell.
Right.
What's next for me? My biggest thing right now, I shouldn't say right now, and it has been for a long time, is trying to make it as an entrepreneur. I work for myself, and to try to be able to live the life I want to live and do the things I want to do. It takes funding, and I am giving it everything I've got to make this brand ambassador type thing work. So my call sign is the Kraken. So Jim the Kraken Irwin is my brand. And what I do is I go out and highlight products, brands, and ideas for companies. So right now I have like Leupold Optics, Gemtech, Silencers, Cryptek Outdoor Group, Falcor Defense, Silverline Films, MCM Firearms. I got several in there, you know, that basically pay me to do social media type things and create content that they would otherwise not get, or what they paid an actor or a model per se. It could be wrong, and could be detrimental to that organization, that company, right? So they're hiring authenticity and background experience. So if Josiah and I go out and we're doing a photo shoot, you know, I'm wearing the kit correctly, you know. We're making sure the stuff's done right, whether it's shooting, standing, whatever it might be. You're bringing that genuine, authentic look, feel, taste, flavor, background. I give input on a lot of these things. You know, if I see a piece of kit that's like, you know, if we did this, most of the time they don't listen, you know.
Of course.
I got millions of dollars worth of freaking research invalidated already. Yeah. But, you know, a lot of times they do too. So bringing that unique thing to it and trying to make a living on that, one of the hardest things I'm finding is this thing called ROI, return on investment.
Right.
Paying me money to go out there and play with your gear and get my picture taken.
You exactly.
Know? Which is huge for them. Like I said, a lot of these guys are starving for that kind of content and the photos and videos that we're creating out there with their gear, you know, whatever it might be. How does that turn into dollars for them? You know, these companies need return on that. If my picture does this, how much money do they get back for it? You can't measure it. It's difficult. So to sell that and create a package for these guys to say, you give me X and I give you Y, they want to see equals Z. It's very difficult to do. Some of them get it. The light bulb goes off and what we're creating. People are like, that's a badass picture. Or that was a cool video. What backpack is that? What optic is that? There's your ROI. People getting interested in creating a buzz over something, or them going and buying it. They can never trace that back to me. It could be somebody in Alabama who just, that's a badass optic. I'm going to go get one.
Right,
you know,
right.
How do you trace that to me? You can't. So that's been a challenge. And getting them to see the light on that is sometimes difficult.
Oh, for
and every
sure.
company's a little different in how we approach it, you know. And I fall back on my protection, like I said. So if that's getting slow, I do the protection stuff. End of day, I would love to have a hunting show and be able to get paid to hunt. I'm a personality on one right now called Prime Revolution, and that's on the Sportsman's Channel. Great bunch of guys, again, sponsored by like Cryptek Outdoor. And
cool.
It's a little close-knit circle of guys that we go out and do this stuff with. And I got my first mule deer on film.
right.
That's
with
too cool.
With a 308 cool. AR.
Nice.
Yeah. Bring the game.
Yeah, no kidding. No kidding. Yeah. That's awesome. Man, Cryptek is just killing it with...
They are.
They really are.
I mean, what an incredible company.
Yeah,
I mean,
and they're great guys, too.
Yeah.
They're close friends of mine as well. And to see Army veterans out there, any veteran, you know, just see veterans out there being successful and kicking ass is awesome. And they come out with a great concept, and they continue to evolve it, and it's far-reaching and will continue to be. And it's a pattern. Here's something else I look at when I'm looking and soliciting brands and companies is, does it work? You know, bottom line, does it work?
Right,
you know?
Right.
If it works, then yeah, man, I'm in. You know, if it makes sense and it works, if you're trying to sell me plastic dog shit, sorry, you know,
right.
I'm not
exactly. going to
rep that for you. You know? You know, but it's like legit stuff, and it can change, you know, how we fight war, or makes you more deadly lethal and saves lives. you know, and or helps you hunt better. You know what I'm saying? It works. It makes sense. I try to promote it a lot that's U.S. made too.
Oh, cool.
You know, not everything can be, obviously, because right. They just couldn't afford it. Nobody can afford a $70 piece of a baseball hat at $70. You know,
right.
Sorry. You know, love to make that in the U.S. You know,
right.
What I'm saying is a lot of it is out there. A lot of it is veteran-owned, and there's a lot of veterans in these brands that I'm getting sponsored by.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
What would you say is one of your biggest failures, or even a number of them, in this entrepreneurial world and in jumping into that?
The biggest failure for me has been – it hasn't been a lack of trying, but the biggest failure for me, honestly, has been I lack in the business side of things. I can go out there and be in front of people all day, talk to them. I'm charismatic, and I truly believe in what I'm talking about, you know, and you can see it when I'm doing it.
Right.
And then to turn around and try to figure out the dollars and cents on the other side and what to charge, I have failed repeatedly at that. I end up just basically giving stuff away. And it's like, shit, you know, I still got to – get gas.
Right.
I just gave everything away.
I think you're branding yourself. I mean, realistically.
And I actually am. You know, Jim McCray, I have literally branded myself as a person.
Right.
And to carry that. But, man, I tell you, I would have a hard road if it wasn't for the guys like, you know, Josiah Ness and Silverline Films and some of my sponsorships that give me guidance on and how to do these things. And the ability to be out there in front of people and then turn around and be able to do your book work and your bookkeeping and this and invoices and try to do all that is a unique ability. And there's a few guys out there I know doing it, and they're good at it.
Right.
I need help on that side. And I've realized it, like I said, over several failed businesses that I've tried on my own. And it turns out, literally, I can't do the business side of it. So had I actually gone to get some schooling on that, I think would have helped. But I'm one of those guys that just – I do it till I make it.
Right,
I just,
exactly.
I just don't quit.
Right.
It might change the face of it, but I'm still going to.
Yeah.
Well, that's important to highlight because I think there's a lot of people out there that are under the impression they need to do it themselves. Mm-hmm. And they,
exactly.
And delegating, there's nothing wrong with delegating. There's nothing wrong with getting help.
I guarantee Joe Ford didn't know how to put an engine together.
Right.
He hired dudes that knew how.
Exactly, exactly. Right. That's what it's all about.
He ran that business, you know.
Right. I mean, I was just talking to somebody the other day that –
I don't think
business.
It was Gerald Ford.
Somebody with cars, building stuff.
He's damn it. Show my ass on that one. Wait, wasn't he president? I didn't know he built trucks.
That guy. Yeah, that guy. Oh, man. But no, I think I was just talking to somebody the other day that their business was growing like crazy. This is a female, and she had this this cupcake business, and it was exploding. To the point where she was having a hard time scaling it, and she didn't want anybody's help, like because she wanted just to do everything herself. She wanted to do all the cooking and organizing and this and that and all these events and all this stuff. She closed the business because she couldn't keep up
with
it all.
That's fucking insane.
Isn't it?
Yeah. That's insane.
Like you would rather close your business than just bite the bullet and bring somebody on. And honestly,
and
you're
teach
going,
them how to do it, you know, under your supervision and how you want it done.
Right.
You're going to be way better off, you know, and you cannot attain anything alone. Like, you need teammates, you need people on your side, you need advisors.
And people that believe in you and what you're doing, you know.
Yes.
And if you've got friends that aren't like that, man, they're not your friends. You know?
Right, right.
That are they're the naysayers and doubters. And like, well, that's not your friend, man. And I've been in the outdoor and tactical gear industry and hunting industry for quite a while, and I know a lot of people. But I have very few close friends, and I know a lot of people.
Right, right.
Well,
that's the way it
should
be.
But I have few close friends, that, you know, and it's the ones that believe in me, what I'm doing, and I believe in them, and I support them back, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's important. And when you get – it's all said and done, you know, everybody's going to the same place, you know. We all got that ticket when we were born, you know, the clock starts ticking and you're all going to check out at some point.
Right.
You know, so how you live your life and who you surround yourself with is something you can control. And do it to the best of your ability.
That's amazing.
I love it.
That's amazing. So being involved in, you know, this entrepreneurial journey, what would you say to people? What keeps you going in the moments where you do fail? How do you pick yourself up?
Fear mostly.
Like, oh,
I'm
shit.
Afraid to fail.
Right.
You know, find a way. Find a way.
It's a huge motivator.
But it's that fear of failure. You know, I don't want to fail, you know. But every small failure I have is a teaching point and a learning point for me that, okay, well, I didn't do that right. You know, how do I fix that? How do I change it? Keep moving forward. I've been I've been blessed, I guess. I do have the protection, you know, stuff to fall back on. I have done, you know, sales for companies and going out. And I, like I said, if I believe in a product, I'll stand behind it and I'll go out there and sell the hell out of it. You know, it's easy because mm-hmm. you do believe. You're not selling something you don't believe in.
Right.
One of the reasons I quit doing that was because I was getting pushed to sell stuff that I didn't believe in. Mm. You know, sell this because it's worth, we make more money.
Mm. Right.
What?
Sorry, dude.
That's not what they wanted. You right. know? It's not what they right. wanted. They right. wanted this. Well, you can't sell them that. We don't make any money. You need to sell them this. Absolutely not. Right. And by the way, I quit. Mm-hmm. You know,
right? Yeah.
But that, so my motivation literally is I just want to be successful, and at the end of this thing, I want to look back and say, you know what, I did what I wanted to do, and I did it right. You know, I may have pissed a few people off here and there, but oh well.
You owned it.
Yeah, I owned it. Yeah, my bad. Sorry.
Yeah,
you know, but right. Maybe we just weren't meant to be friends.
You know? Exactly. Exactly.
So
does that relate any way during your time in the military when you would encounter tough spots or tough
absolutely.
Times.
I just refuse to quit, man. And I think that's an attribute that's it's a blessing and a curse.
Right.
But yeah. It's why I made it where I made it in the units I got to is because you, mm-hmm. I just absolutely refuse to quit. You'd had to pull me off the side of that mountain kicking and screaming. If I had broken legs, I would have used my hands and teeth to keep moving mm-hmm. Because I just wasn't going to I wasn't going to fail because of me, if that makes sense. I wasn't
yeah,
going
absolutely.
To quit.
Right.
And they'll push you to that point where you want to quit, but I wasn't going to give them the satisfaction.
Right, like, exactly.
Absolutely not. You know, you have to fire me, shoot me, you know, pull me off here kicking and screaming.
Right.
But it won't be because I failed me. You know, mm. I may have failed or did not meet their criteria or a time requirement I didn't know or something like that, which fortunately for me didn't happen, but that's one thing. For you to just wake up and be like, yeah, fuck this. I don't want to do it.
Right.
That in the military to me was like, if you did it once, you'll do it again. And you will amount
sure.
to, you'll never overcome a difficult challenge if you're willing to just, yeah, screw it. You know, mm-hmm. that's too hard. It can be too hard. Get your ass kicked. It'll
right.
teach you how to fight
right.
harder, you know? So,
right.
Do you think that's a characteristic that people are born with, or do you think that's something you can learn?
You know, I'm not sure.
That will, that
I don't know
drive.
If I learned it or if I just was just stubborn as hell from early on.
Right, right.
I'm thinking maybe you're kind of born with it, but can it be acquired? I bet you can. I mean, because you can – I've trained guys to – like a good example would be from when I was out there, we'd do force-on-force stuff. So you got guns, I got guns, and we're going to go at each other, you know. And back in the day, they had this laser thing, you pew, and your thing goes off. Okay, I'm dead.
Right.
Fuck that. You keep right. going. Take the battery out. Keep going. Yeah. Whatever you got to do to stay in the fight, right?
Yeah.
Right. Because what does that train you to do? Beep. Oh, I'm down. And I got – so I'm teaching guys, and I'm taking hits. Like, we're doing this training. I'm, like, stitched, man. I got, like, 8-10 shots through. Like, you know, I'm just getting blasted on this guy.
Yeah.
I still hose this dude down. You know, I was like, screw you, man.
Right.
Boom, boom, boom,
right.
boom. He's like,
yeah.
Oh, okay. Like, and I finished my mission, whatever we were doing. You know, like I said, this is training. I'm not, like – nailing this dude with real ammo, you know, it's
right.
ammunition,
right.
you know, so I'm getting hit, he's getting hit, and I'm just like, back then, I was like, bam, bam, oh, I'm down, bullshit, I just kept going, I went right through that dude,
right,
finished
right.
the mission, this and that, so it trains you to continue the fight, you know, regardless if you're getting hit or not, and I think that is trainable, you know, so where you can take that and manipulate it and teach beyond that instead of this, oh, I'm hit, I'm down, and when I left and went to the LRS unit, and I'm doing CQB training with those guys, one guy, like, takes a piece of wood kicked off or something and hits him and he's like, oh, I'm down. I'm like, I lost my shit right there. I'm like, get up. You know, like, you're never down. You know, like, this and that. He's freaking like, oh my God. He thought I was going to choke him out right there.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, you cannot program yourself to just, oh, okay, I'm down. It's like the red, that's like the damn buzzer going
yeah.
off in the old laser tag crap.
Right.
You know, beep. Well, how fucking bad is it? You know,
mm-hmm.
what's my card say?
Oh. You know, right.
And
right.
I chipped a nail. And no,
yeah.
come on, man. Just keep going. So I got told, this is one mission. I got told, okay, you're going to be the casualty. So when you go, you know, once we go in, you know, and breach the first door, you go down and suddenly our medic, you think I did? Hell no.
Right.
They caught me going out the back, you know, before
right.
they're like, yeah. You know, I was already through the building, going out the back, getting ready to extract. They had to do that stuff on the helicopter because I refused to die.
Oh, nice.
Or, you know, be the injured dude. You
yeah,
know?
Yeah.
Like, let my team down if I go to, you know.
That's so funny.
I was hauling ass. Sergeant Major finally had to grab me. He's like,
damn it. You know, like,
that's, you train yourself and you stay in the fight, man. Stay in the fight. And not only if you're a military, a veteran, it applies to all. If you're a veteran, man, stay in the fight, bro. You know,
right.
Don't check out early. You got friends, you got people around you. Stay that mentally tough. No, days do suck here and there, man, but. Mm-hmm. And come out the other end. You know,
exactly.
Make them get you on the backside.
Hell yeah.
Do it on the front.
Right. So I love it.
What was the most difficult part coming back? Because, you know, you hear
puberty.
No. Sorry. I got to throw it in here.
No, but you hear these stories about you know, how difficult it is. I can't relate. Connor can't relate.
It's all difficult. There is no one thing. It's the one thing. When you think you understand it, it'll change. You know, so
okay.
It's all difficult, man. Life, jobs, training, entrepreneurship, working for yourself, working for the government. It's all hard. It's just how you approach it and whether you want to be miserable or you want to attack it, you know, and enjoy life. And I've chosen to, you know, I kid around a lot. You know, I've been in some serious, serious shit. I've been shot at, rocketed, bombed, mortared, you know. And people ask, well, like, well, that was a pretty serious job, and you're kind of a crack up. I said, yeah, there's a time to be an asshole, you know, and there's a time to get work done. But do I have to be that dude all day, every day?
Right.
Like, do I have to be a dick all the time? Absolutely not. Man. That was a job. It doesn't define me as a human.
Right.
You know, so don't forget you're human. You know, just because you had a kick-ass job or you're doing kick-ass stuff or you've been hurt and kicked and knocked down, you're still human, man. Fucking the fight ain't over until the old man upstairs says so. You know,
that's so cool.
Give him a lead.
Right. That is so awesome. And I think a lot of that ties into what you're talking about with, you know, never going down and staying in the fight. And it is interesting, you know, where that mental fortitude comes from, you know, and a lot of it, I think, is trainable to an extent. But I think
if you can inspire and motivate somebody, you can change that fucking mindset. And we do it with the Veteran Sports Alliance. That's a key thing for me. If you can be out there and just be happy, man, and excited to do things and smiling, I could sit here and tell you stupid stories and drink a beer and just, you know, tell you how awesome I am and everybody else sucks. That's just not the truth, man. It's like, I want to live and have a good time. If I can make somebody laugh in the day, I'm having a good day, man. I get a kick out of that.
Right.
I've done some serious stuff. I've had some seriously cool jobs. But at the end of the day, it was just a job. It's not me as a human, you know. I think some people let that escape them and they think that the job – becomes them, and they have this title, and just because I don't care if you were an airman, you know, a tanker, this or that, man. Thank you for what you did. You know, I didn't want to do it, but we all had to do it and do our job so that we come out the other end alive. Mm-hmm. You know, there was somebody that flew me over there. You know, just because he wasn't kicking in the door and shooting people in the face doesn't make him a lesser man.
Right,
you know, he's had a different job, man.
Exactly. That's too cool. That's really, really great advice for a lot of people.
That's really an amazing insight, too.
It really is. And I think, too, that...
I almost cried right there,
I saw it. I saw it. You barely held it together.
Lip quivered a bit.
But I thought it was really, really interesting, your take on fear, because fear holds back so many people. They're afraid of failure, so they don't try shit.
I embrace that shit.
It'll
open your eyes. It'll wake you up. If somebody tells you they're not scared when shit's going down, I was each and every time. And it heightened awareness.
Your eyes
are this damn big, you know, and you smell, see everything. You know?
No kidding.
Where I used to lose, like, my mouth would go dry immediately.
Really?
Shit would get going. You know, I'd remember my mouth just go.
I can't even fucking imagine being in a situation like that.
Yeah. Right.
I don't know, man. I guess that's what they train you for, but it's just...
Hey, as long as somebody opened my door and got me off the floorboard, because I was hiding most of the time.
You're just shooting Erwin. Erwin, get out of the Humvee, man. that's awesome.
Right. Erwin's not here.
he's not here right now.
Yeah. That's part of why what keeps you alive, man. You don't have fear. Yeah. You might do something like that. Get you killed, you know.
That's so true.
Right.
And, you know, if you have fear, you might do something that might get you killed as well. I mean, it's a balance, and I don't have the answer, but I used it to the best of my ability, man.
That's all you can do.
So
How did you manage the adrenaline in those moments like that, and how did you manage it coming off of the adrenaline after the fact?
You know, I don't know how I managed it, because you definitely have some adrenaline going, man, and it almost, I don't know. I don't know if I ever did manage it, but you dealt with it. And believe it or not, working in areas like that, in situations like that, where you're doing missions every day, every time you go out that gate, dude, it, they call them roadside bombs for a reason, you know, and all I was doing is running the roads every day. You know? Like that shit, you know, you could die any given day going out the door. So, you know, heightened sense of awareness, the adrenaline, you know, you start getting people watching you, you know, and you're pinging, you know, so you're like redlining a lot of times. And the boys out there kicking in doors, you know, getting shot at and fighting the fight face to face, man. And they're getting these huge adrenaline dumps day in and day out, months on end. You manage it. It just, there's no other way to do it, I guess. But what I found a little bit, and a lot of my buddies that were coming back, is that adrenal dump, like the fatigue. When you come back and you actually come out of the red, you know, you, and like you can only stay there so long, man. Like
right,
bouncing the rev limiter, and then you come home and it's like nobody's shooting at you. You know, you're not having to dodge freaking cars, which sometimes you do anyway because you just forget. done that, and all of a sudden you're dragging ass. You're lethargic. You're shit's not working downstairs. Like, it's hard to get a hard on. I'm not naming bullshit. Like,
really?
Because you just...
That's interesting.
We're running with all that adrenaline. Now you're just... You're home and there isn't any, and you just have, like, this dump, man. And it's actually your body's not producing it and because you've been running on it.
Yeah.
And there's studies. I got buddies that are just, like, they had to start getting, like, testosterone shots and stuff. And like, something's fucked up here. Like, I'm messed up. And a lot of it was, like, I think it was, like, adrenal fatigue. They just weren't producing it and running on it for all the months or 18, you know, these deployments, and then come home and nothing's going on. Your biggest excitement's freaking Call of Duty. Like, that's it. And your old lady's wondering why you're dragging ass and not wanting to have, like, something's up, you know. So that's something that's being dealt with and looked at. It's funny you mentioned that, but that's a serious, actually, a medical condition that they're having to deal with. These boys,
that's
coming
interesting.
Home.
That's really, really,
I never would have thought.
That's not something that anybody would ever really think of, really. Yeah,
just out of the blue. Like, you're not less of a man. You're like, you're not getting it up. It's just like, there's a problem.
Exactly. Yeah,
it's not taking Advil and call me tomorrow. Like, you need help. You need to have this looked at, not cover it with some sort of medication.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think the effects of that runs.
Okay, perfect. Okay.
Yeah. The effects of that run so deep. You know, there's so many different things that are probably affected coming back from that. You know, that included, right? Mm-hmm. Things that we haven't even thought of before that are now coming into fruition. Mm-hmm. We're talking about, it's absolutely insane. I couldn't even imagine that.
Oh, and seriously.
It's just unfathomable, really, for people that haven't been through that and experienced that. And you know, we really appreciate you, man. I appreciate you, and we want to thank you for your service.
I appreciate you having me on the show.
Oh, absolutely. Not a problem at all. Thanks so much for joining us. I'll finish off with a few more questions just from some of our audience here. We had somebody ask, what are some best practices for staying safe while traveling abroad?
Best practices traveling abroad for me is usually being situationally aware and vigilance. In travel, I see a lot of people, believe it or not, like on their cell phone or headphones in, and they're looking down. I can be on top of that dude or that person so fast before they're even aware that you're within their, like, their cone of their circle of, like, you know, in their circle. Yeah, I guess the best way to put it. Like, you can be on them so fast. That's a victim walking around. Mm-hmm. You know, be heads up. Be looking around. Make eye contact with people. You know, if you can identify somebody and you look them dead in the eye, you're not that victim because they're looking for the guy that doesn't recognize them. You know, and you make that eye contact and you carry yourself with confidence. That's what I do. They're looking for the person with their head down and they can snatch something or, you know, whatever it is, make you that victim and be out of there before you even know what's going on. But if you're head up, you're aware, and your head's on a swivel and you're making eye contact with people, you know, you're not that sheep. You know, you're not that dude that's to be messed with or woman. Because you're not an easy target at that point.
Right.
You're switched on.
That's different. We're always talking about cell phones while you're driving, but that's something to know.
Oh, I see
a lot of
places,
man. They're head down. I said, dude, could come by. I was in New York working for a bit, and see guys, men, women with their heads down, their headphones in, or they'd have their, like, phone up and kind of looking down. And there was a trend going on where people were coming in behind them and just boom, like hitting them and snatching their phone at the same time. So as they're grabbing the phone, they're trying to knock them down and keep going.
Oh, wow.
But if you're up and, you know,
right,
paying attention, you know, or if you have one earpiece in instead of two, exactly, you know, that you can actually kind of hear what the hell is going on. Somebody's running, you can hear that shit.
Exactly.
You're going to want to look, you know. It's like,
right, right.
That's super.
I take it a step further, too. Like when I go into, say, a place to eat, I always check where the exits are. You know, where I'm sitting, can I see the door and the window, see what's coming, what's transpiring in front of me? You know, hell, I'll check, see how thick the damn table is. Can I use that for cover?
Yeah.
It starts breaking off, you know.
Yeah. Right.
Where's the bathrooms? Where are the exits? Right. Can I throw this table through that window? You know, I do stuff like that. It's a little trippy. It's a little my girlfriend's starting to get used to, like, okay, where do you want to sit? When we go to, so I can see this spot right
here.
Yeah,
yeah, this is perfect.
Yeah. Right, right. Yeah.
No, that's awesome. Yeah, I see that all the time. You know,
hopefully people, that answers the question.
No,
that's part of it. You know, head it's up, be aware, man, and be confident.
Even if you're at home, I mean, Jesus, I see so many people walking around with their heads down, totally unaware.
Yeah, oblivious, man.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely oblivious. Yeah. So great advice there, great advice there. Let's see, what do we have on the rest of the list here? What would you say to others embarking on an SF or SO career path?
Again, don't quit. You know, they'll do everything they can to make you quit. You just don't quit. You know, make them make the choice, not you. If you're not cut out to be special forces or spec ops, make them make the decision. Don't you be your own worst enemy on that, man. Just you do everything you can and just you fight every day for it. And if that's really the job you want, you know, take that fucking step. You make one foot in front of the other every day.
Right.
You know, start rucking a lot. Put a backpack on. Start hiking. You know, everybody likes to, you know, the speed goats out there. They can run like gazelles, but at the end of the day, you're putting weight on and you're going to be humping.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So, you know, have some stamina. Don't be just a runner. You know, mm-hmm. Used to kill me. You know?
Right, you know, right.
I wasn't the biggest or the, you know, the fastest guy out there, but I could run damn near as fast with a rucksack on as I did without.
Balanced it out just perfect.
And the guys hated me for that because I go run with the teams and they'd just freaking blaze it and I'd be struggling back there, you know, 235 pounds. Like, right. And then I'd do PT and we'd put rucks on and go 8 miles and they'd just be like, like just dying.
Right, right.
I'm just like, here we go. Payback, baby.
Right.
So,
no
yeah,
kidding.
Put that ruck out, man. Get that stamina, get that endurance and ability and have that mental toughness, man. Mental toughness will defeat most everything you'll come across.
Awesome. I love it. And, the final question, we always ask this question to our guests. It's kind of a tradition here at Forge Your Potential. And the last question is, if you had right now the entire world's attention, everybody's listening to you, watching you, what would you say?
Just say no to Killery.
Yes. Yes.
I love it. I love it.
What would I say, man? You know, just... It's an amazing world we live in, man, you know, and embrace it and take every day as a challenge and continue to try to just make it yours, man. You know, that's how
amazing.
I live.
Amazing.
I love it, man. Thanks so much. Thanks so much for joining us, Jim.
Yeah. Follow me on Facebook at Jim Irwin Elite and also on Instagram at Jim_the Kraken_Irwin, E-R-W-I-N.
Perfect. You know, perfect.
And we'll do a lot of fun of stuff, and we're out there doing stuff, whether it's funny or serious, or you know, a lot of the brand stuff we do out there, and it's a good time. And we, like I said, if you don't mind, give me a follow, check it out.
Absolutely, we'll put all the links again in the show notes. Yes. So everybody listening out there in the Forge Your Potential Legion, go check that out. Go give the Kraken a follow and get in touch with him. We can vouch for the funny and badass claims because we just saw some photos.
Yeah, you can never say you're badass. Somebody has to tell you.
Exactly.
You can't self-claim that.
No, we can totally vouch.
You are badass.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Awesome, Jim. Hey, thanks so much for joining us, man.
And thanks, I really appreciate you having me on.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's been amazing. Well, you guys take care. Remember, as always, today is the day.